Every part of the student support services tells a story, and our staff enjoys those stories. Our staff works at knowing your children well and then responding to the needs of our learners. Each type of service is uniquely tailored to meet the individual needs of each student. Grand Rapids Christian Schools have developed a unique culture of learning, where at an early age, children are supported and enfolded to reach their full academic and behavior and social potential. Our inclusion services nurture a loving and accepting spirit where children are learning from one another how to love as Christ loves us. Our educational support services engage our students with our students at every level to enhance and support their learning. Tonight, you will hear the story of one of my students, Evan Dykstra. Evan joins me in third grade with his classmates. Evan loves to do anything that has to do with insects or nature. His peers respect him and his passion for insects and God's creation. This past fall, Evan would help students catch numerous grasshoppers out during recess time for our study of insects. He had a way of knowing just where those insects were on the playground. In fact, he was able sometimes to just reach out and walk around with several grasshoppers on his arms. They never moved. Here's Evan. And here it is. His classmates started calling him the grasshopper whisperer. Evan knows hundreds of facts about God's incredible creation. In Christian education, we have the privilege of walking alongside our students and helping them develop their faith formation. Evan willingly shares his love for Jesus with his classmates by compassionately being a friend, by eagerly lending a helping hand, and with a childlike faith, Evan often will volunteer to pray for his classmates. Learning is difficult for Evan. Yet this does not limit Evan's curious mind and positive attitude toward learning. Evan brings a special touch to our third grade class. Evan's parents are Brent and Michelle Dykstra. They have been married for 16 years. Brent is an architect with AMDG, and Michelle is a speech pathologist working mostly with a geriatric population and treating clients on the side. She is also founding members of River City Improv and enjoys various acting opportunities. They have three children who are part of the Grit schools. Case, their oldest, is in eighth grade. Kendall is in seventh grade. And Evan, their masterpiece number three, is in third grade. As a family, they like spending time together camping, traveling, and boating, and they enjoy playing with their dog Cricket. Tonight, Michelle will share with us Evan's story of living with multiple invisible diagnoses and how he has been able to thrive due to the compassion and the determination of his teachers and the support he receives from the support services staff. Will you join me in welcoming his mom, Michelle Dykstra?
Struggle with special needs or disabilities and are currently attending one of the Grand Rapids Christian Schools. schools at this time. I want you to know that you are not alone, that we stand alongside you to support you through these years of schooling. I include myself as one of those people that stand alongside you. As Sue mentioned, we have 3 great kids. Each of our children has been blessed with their own individual gifts. Intelligence, kindness, creativity, you name it. Can't say that they're athletically blessed. They are exceptional in their own ways. Our eldest is driven to perfection. He's among those with straight A's. His brain is a sponge and it never stops. He's gifted in math and science, and I would also add arguing. His brain is a sponge. And now, despite the focus of the speech being on Evan, I also want to mention that the sports services here in the Grant system offer help to kids like this, kids whose brains are ahead of their bodies, whose brains don't stop moving. By middle school, Case was regularly being pulled aside or pulled out for accelerated math and has benefited from it tremendously. No more complaints of being bored in school classrooms. Now, if I can get him to remember to shut a door to turn off a light, we'd be in business, right? Our daughter Kendall has the organizational skills of a top-notch administrator or type A wedding planner. She works hard for her grades. She's creative, crafty, take that how you'd like, kind-hearted, loves to read, and loves our dog Cricket. She has a keen eye for what she doesn't like in this world and what she does like. Say she's a bit like Martha Stewart, minus the prison time. Recently, she started acting, and I couldn't be happier myself, having come from that sort of field of work. And this month, she's in the middle school play that will begin tomorrow, Around the World in 80 Days, and I couldn't be happier. Both of these kids, like I said, are exceptional. Both of them are fearfully and wonderfully made. And then we have our son, Evan. Evan, too, is exceptional, and he, too, is fearfully and wonderfully made. He is social, he is sweet, he is social, he is sweet, and well-liked amongst his peers. We have discovered that he is very spiritual, and has a way of communicating with God that makes you see the true innocence of a child, something that Sue even mentioned, we weren't coordinating her speeches, and see how big of a heart he has for others. He is obsessed with bugs, also mentioned, and reptiles. He loves riding his bike, he loves video games, and currently he enjoys rock climbing. He also enjoys Star Wars and sometimes thinks of himself as a Jedi, a lot like most nine-year-old boys. He hugs with gusto, and he loves to bathe with me. And to be honest, he is a kid that most people fall in love with. He is a kid that people get gushy about when they start talking about Evan, and it is not uncommon for me to hear, "Oh, I miss Evan," when they haven't seen him for a while. Yeah, I would say he's got a fan club with anyone in our family. But despite Evan's charms and winning personality, he was born with many challenges. He looks normal on the outside, and if you were with him for a while, you probably wouldn't even notice that there were any problems. This is both a gift and a frustration. Evan's disabilities, or impairments, for the most part, are what you call invisible. No one sees him or feels bad for him. He doesn't have any tics or behaviors that call out attention. For the most part, he's a healthy kid. But his brain is not the same as yours and mine. It is not the same as a neurotypical brain. And those differences that he has are just as real and visible. And do impact our family, his academics, and his behaviors in many real ways. It's because of these differences that the educational support staff and the inclusion services have come alongside us and Evan and helped us to discover where his gifts lie. Okay, so now you're probably wondering what's wrong with this kid, right? Well, in simple terms, and not just to give you a list, but I'm going to give it to you, Evan has sensory processing disorder, a visual processing disorder, ADD, a learning disability, and he's been diagnosed with what they call nonverbal learning disorder. I promise I will explain a bit more of these later. Okay, I think I'm ahead of myself here. Sorry about that. Here's a picture of Evan crying. It's not the one I had queued up earlier, but we knew from day one that there was something wrong with Evan, or at least I did. This is a kid who cried for 3 years. And I mean, he was not able to be soothed. He went from crying to cranky. As you see, years pass. We still have the same formal picture being taken. He's not crying, but he's at least, you know, he's there. Anyway, he went from crying to cranky. By the time he was 3, he had been given a diagnosis of sensory processing disorder, or as I'm going to refer to it from now on as SPD. At this time, he was also diagnosed with a speech and language delay, and for the speech pathologist, the irony of that was not lost on me. Several more diagnoses would be added later on, and I will get to them later. But I want you to first know all of these diagnoses that I've given you, all of these things that I've listed are not my son. These labels are not my son. Life is challenging for Evan. Yes, he works really, really hard to do the things that every typical kid does every day. But you know what? He still is a happy kid at heart. There is joy in this kid's life. And despite having diagnoses that certainly will be with him and a part of him for the rest of his life, they don't define him. And they don't define anybody else who has a kid who struggles with special needs either. He is first and foremost a child of God, who is fearfully and wonderfully made. That means his brain, too. Just like yours and mine. Just like my other children. Second, he is God's gift to us, to me and to Brent, to our family and to our community. He makes me laugh every day. He's further my understanding of kids with disabilities. He's taught us patience. He's taught me how to pray. I think all of our kids teach us how to pray. And maybe, most importantly, we know by our faith that he still has been given everything he needs to succeed in this life to bring glory to God, no matter what he does. He's been fully equipped for his future, and God has this future full with hope. What a gift it is for us to know this, and to know the staff of Grand Rapids Christian and the support staff reinforce these thoughts every day. Okay, as I said, Evan was diagnosed with SPD early on. And SPD, can I just have a show of hands? How many people know what sensory processing disorder is? Okay, so about half of you. Well, for the other half, I'm going to briefly explain. Okay, sensory processing disorder is a condition where the brain receives, it organizes, and it processes information that comes in through our senses. And those signals tell us how to move, they tell us where to move, they tell us how to react, and where to attend. Now, kids that have sensory processing disorder have difficulty taking all of these signals in and acting on them. So they either seem overreactive to things or perhaps avoidant. In addition, it varies from kid to kid how it's going to look. So what Evan looks like, or what SPD looks like in Evan is this. You think, oh, this kid is just really active. But to be honest, Evan's body never stops moving. He is what you call a sensory seeker. He craves sensory input. It's perpetually looking for deep input, for pressure of some sort. For him to sit still for any length of time, think church, or even sitting for a meal for that matter, is torture. Fidgets are really handy. Even when he has his ADD meds, because those do help, but that's not everything. Sitting behind a desk for any length of time is tremendous work for this kid. His body literally is never at rest. He moves to feel. He craves chewing gum, chewing ice, and he's mad at me when I don't have gum in my purse. I buy it in bulk. He loves to climb door frames and jump off her counters and to be squished by his dad. And like I mentioned earlier, I've been taking him regularly to a rock climbing place, and there he thrives. He gets all the sensory input he needs. Now here's an irony. He chooses to feel soft things on his face. So Evan chooses to pet the dog with his face. He chooses to feel his blanket over and over against his chin and his cheeks, because that's where the sensitive part of his face is. His hands, his arms don't feel those things like yours and mine. I remember one time when he was probably 3 years old, I had made sausage and eggs for breakfast one day, and he took the sausage, he looked at it, and he put it to his forehead and said, "Ooh, that feels good." Not your typical reaction. Most kids would probably eat that at first. But that's the life of a sensory processing disordered kid. And again, the paradox with Evan is this. For as much as his body seeks out information, it also is highly sensitive and highly avoidant of information. He hates the seams in his pants. He hates the seams that you find in every single pair of socks. There are no socks without seams. I have looked everywhere. Lately, I found that laughter, loud laughter, will set him off. This does not bode well for a woman who does comedy for a living. It's no wonder he is prone to whining at home and throwing tantrums. Those first years for Evan were tremendously difficult for Brent and I. And I am so grateful that we are no longer there. Evan has come such a long way. I won't go into the details, but when you have a kid with a disability, with special needs, kind of go through this process of guilt and constant grieving. You grieve over sort of what could have been, what should have been, or what can't be. And you're happy for those times when your child accomplishes something, but they're always delayed, they're always tempered by the next step he needs to accomplish to meet up to his peers. And don't get me wrong, because there were plenty of times when we laughed and had good times too, but we muddled through those first few years. We made it through with God's grace, and for me, a glass of wine. I'm going to skip forward now in Evan's timeline to first grade. And by no means do I want to overshadow the work that he put into 2 years of kindergarten and a year of preschool. But during that first year of Evan's, during that first grade, his teacher's share of Rosendahl proved to be a catalyst in steering us towards resources outside of the school that could better serve or understand Evan and his challenges. Oh, there he is crying again. So I've been getting some therapy for his sensory processing. After having him in class for a couple months, she noticed Evan struggling with reading and writing and math, and to her eyes, it wasn't just the sensory processing disorder or attention problems that were affecting him, although they probably did have some portion to do with what was going on. A recommendation was made to have Evan evaluated somewhere else, and in December of that year, we took him to the Brains Clinic, where a full neuropsychological evaluation took place. There, he was given the diagnoses of visual processing disorder, the ADD, a learning disability, and the nonverbal learning disorder. That information we gained was both empowering and sobering. Mostly, it was just new names and an understanding of, oh, that's what's going on. It should be said at this point, too, that Evan really was a model student at school. Very sweet and respectful, very much the hard worker. But at home, it was a different picture. Lots of tantrums and meltdowns, and discipline was always tricky. There's Evan in preschool. And he's getting some sensory time. And he ate this punch. He still tries to climb in it, so. Okay, I'm on the list. The nonverbal learning disorder. That was the final piece that I needed to hear to understand the subtle and the not so subtle differences in my kid. You know, it explained things like Evan's obsessions with reptiles or insects and trains. Of course, I'm going to blame that one on my husband, if you know my husband, or his difficulty with transitions. It is nearly impossible to move Evan from from, let's say, watching television to getting a coat on and moving them out the door without having some sort of tantrum. We still struggle with that every day. It explains the difficulty he has with math, with fine motor organization, with tying his shoe. It explained things like his inability to understand when his siblings were teasing him and with the frequent bursts of anger he would have as a result. It explained why at 3 years of age, when Brent kiddingly said he was going to sell him on Craigslist, he would burst into tears. He actually thought he was going to be sold. Poor kid. It's funny now, but you know, we didn't understand why he was crying. You know, he's now working on things like understanding how to use proper tone of voice. In school, it seems to be fine, but at home, we're still struggling with sarcasm isn't always the right call. Our second meeting that first grade year was also critical. Cheryl Rosendahl's insight again was pretty providential. It pushed us towards our next big move in Evan's academic success or achievements. The things that she was noticing, Evan was struggling with the visual part, and it was affecting his classwork, so tracking and reading were really greatly affected. He hated reading and writing, and it was more to her than just, you know, the overlying nonverbal stuff and the sensory stuff again. So, again, on recommendation, we went and had his visual processing more officially tested in May. And by that, I mean, visual processing is not the same as visual acuity. Visual acuity is how well you see something. Visual processing is how your brain interprets what you see. So, and what we found out is it affected Evan so much. His ability to copy, to read, to track, to take another visual perspective, to know where his body was in space, to remember things he had just seen, this would explain his memory, and to be able to retrace his steps. Starting in June of that year and continuing throughout the entire second grade year, Evan received visual therapy every Friday morning for an hour. At home, Evan participated in visual therapy homework anywhere from 2 to 4 times a week, provided he would participate. Let's see, there's Evan doing some visual therapy. And at this time, he was still going to the sensory room. Evan had been using the sensory room every day, pretty much, throughout the week. And he would meet up this year with Jill Mulder. Now, I don't know if Jill knows this, but I wonder if she's even here tonight. Still here tonight? But I have to tell you, you have earned a special place in my heart. As Evan was given daily visual therapy tasks to do at home, and then he was given homework, we had nightly battles. And anybody who's got a kid who doesn't like to do homework and struggles with their kid doing homework can attest to the fact that that's just draining. And I know that my kid, and I knew that my kid needed to do these things to get better so that he could accomplish more later on. And so I was feeling this tremendous pressure. Jill and I had this meeting one time when I went in to see how he was doing in sensory, and she had this idea, hey, what if I do the sensory or the visual therapy task while he's in sensory? And she did. She took over the visual therapy during his sensory time and sort of did them both together. It was because of Jill that Evan would complete visual therapy tasks, and because of her help, that he met such great success. Evan is no longer seeing double, something we were shocked to find out at a 6-month checkup, and we had no clue what that was going on with our kid up until that point. He's able to track lines in a paragraph or in a book now. He reads at grade level, still struggles with a bit of comprehension, but can't read. He can catch a ball. And gratefully, he doesn't hit his head on cupboards or doors and things like that as much anymore, which is a significant improvement in this kid's life. He just bruises all over his head because we hit him all the time. So thank you, Jill, and thank you, Cheryl, wherever you are, for getting to the bottom of kids' issues over those 2 years. Your diligence and the educational support staff have been so helpful. And now here we are in third grade, driving under the teaching of Sue Clymer. I think I got another picture. Oh, there's Evan's graduation from visual therapy. Yeah, they did hold young Kathy down. That was kind of cool. And there's Evan with his followers. He's showing them the bugs. There's a couple of his friends. This is time at Camp Roger where he's learning how to start a fire. His matches. Anyway, God has once again provided us with an amazing instructor who happily joins us on our journey. Sue has been a phenomenal communicator with us, insightful and encouraging cheerleader for Evan. We parents need that on our journey. It's so easy to see the things that Evan can't do, struggles, or how he might not be measuring up to his peers, but Sue has only seen the bright side in our child, and I love that. She honestly makes me beam when I walk away out of her room, and to be honest, there are a few times I can say I beam over my son. Thank you. For your love and your optimism, and seeing that my son is complete, no matter what his struggles are. Thank you for loving him, for what he can do, and despite the things that he can't. Evan has been working on attention and math this year. He can focus for longer periods of time now, thanks to modern medication. His math has been a tremendous difficulty for this kid. Lots of challenges along the way. And in an emotional meeting we had with the support services in October, we decided to move him to a different curriculum. It was no longer going to be part of the inclusion, and that we had to pull him out and tutor him individually. This notion, I have to tell you, has met with many tears, mine, not Brent's. And actually some of the support staff as well. Again, I grieve that what could not be. And I was also thinking about what are his peers going to think? You know, my kid's going to look different again. You know, he's going to come across as odd. I was so concerned about the perception all of a sudden. But it was then that Mark Cronendike, principal, gently reminded me that morning and Brent that we could deal with the other kids' perception about Evan being pulled from regular math. What's difficult is failing every day at the math you're in and dealing with that. It was really the wake-up call that I needed to hear. And it was really the best thing for Evan, and it was an excellent perspective. So thank you, Mark. You had my child's heart and mind, not just his head, and that meant so much to me and to Brent. Now he gets pulled for individual math, and he actually likes it. He loves it. He loves working with Mrs. Carell and Mrs. Jen, and he says his head doesn't hurt as much. So that, to me, is success. We are encouraged and blessed by it, by everyone. So there you have it. That's Evan in a nutshell. We can't predict what Evan's future holds. We know, no doubt, it will be filled with more struggles along the way. More joys too, of course, and a widening gap academically as he goes along with schooling. But we trust that God holds his future. While he remains here at Grand Rapids Christian, we know that he will be enfolded and cared for, not just academically, but also emotionally and spiritually as God's child. I truly believe that this is an accurate reflection of God's kingdom here on earth now. What a wonderful thing it is to see that we can all be accepted where we are for who we are, invisible diagnoses or not. Thank you.
very much. Brent, thanks for being a part of this and for sharing the story with us. You know, I've been a part of Circle of Friends for a long time now. We've done this for a number of years, and one of the things that never ceases to amaze me is just how incredibly complicated kids are, and how incredibly complicated and how beautifully made they really truly are. One of the most important values we have as a system, and I think it's a value that runs very deep and goes back very many years, is that we don't just educate kids who all look alike, who come from the same family kinds of backgrounds, who all have Christian Reformed written behind their church attendance name, who are all colors, all sizes, all shapes, and it's a beautiful thing. And I think that that's unique, and I don't say that lightly. And I also believe that that's a wonderful opportunity for us and for this community to take steps to reflect a kingdom of God that looks very, very different. It's so easy when you're looking on the outside in to assume we or other faith-based institutions like ours do a certain thing or act a certain way or believe a one single thing. And that's really unfortunate because Grand Rapids Christian, I know and believe in my heart, has done so much for so many for such a long time. And with that opportunity comes a very significant challenge, and that is, how do we do it? How can we continue to move forward in faith and in confidence that we will be able to do the things that we profess and believe strongly that we should do? If you can imagine the complexity of a K-12, pre-K-12 system that welcomes nearly everyone, that manages to personalize learning with heartfelt appreciation and humility in a servant attitude, and does it so well, then you can imagine and in your mind's eye can picture what Grand Rapids Christian is about. And it's an honor and privilege, very humbling for me personally, and I know for our staff and our administrators, to be able to continue to do this and to do it as well as we do. That being said, we can't do it without you. This year, the Circle of Friends had a goal of raising approximately $150,000, and I know that as of today, through the Circle of Friends event, and from gifts that have been designated to support our educational support services this year, we have surpassed $170,000. How much more can people give? And yet they do. It's unbelievable. People give sacrificially. They give from their heart, and they give because they love kids and they love Grand Rapids Christian, and they deeply recognize how important God's kingdom is in the development of, and the growing, and the maturation, and the education of children from when they're very young to when they're ready to go on to post-high school work, family, community, school. Thank you for that. Thank you for doing what you do to help us achieve this. We don't always do it exactly right, but we always do it out of heartfelt thanks and service to what we believe to be best for kids. And your support of this effort is appreciated more than you even know. Every year we wonder, will we make it? And every year we do. Thank you for doing that. To our staff that are here, the ESS and inclusion staff, the teachers, the support staff, the administrative team, Cheryl, I know your folks are kind of spread everywhere. They're incredible. They love your kids, they love all the kids, and they work hard to support the learning of all kids. And I'm so thankful that they're with us and that they continue to serve in the capacity that they serve. So thank you for all you do. And to our advancement team, I know you guys work and sweat and cry over all of these things that we do, worrying about what it is that it's going to be like. And you've done a great job. The high school is an awesome place to host here in the town square. I remember our first ones were up in the upper commons, and it sure is a lot nicer now. And it's really a gracious environment. So I know, Leah, you worked hard on this. Mark, I know you worked hard on this. Lorreen, Kathleen, thank you. Thanks for all your work. So this year's Circle of Friends event is, Circle of Friends is done. We're concluded for the night, but that does not mean you are asked to leave, because you may stay as long as you like. Grand Rapids Christian is a home for you, and you are welcome here anytime, and you are welcome here as long as you would like to stay and have conversation with your friends and family. There's lots of food left, I'm sure, and there's lots of room to spread out and have some fun, so please make sure you make this your home and stay as long as you'd like. You're welcome to do that. Michelle and Brett, thanks again. I'm sure your family is here with you. I don't know if you want to just quickly point them out, because grandpas and grandmas mean an awful lot. Thank you for being here. And thanks, everybody, for participating this year. Don't forget, we will celebrate Circle of Friends again next year. I don't know if that date's been determined, but if it hasn't been yet, it will be soon, and I know you'll hear more about that. Thank you for making this a reality for us and for all you do to help us help kids. Enjoy your night, everybody, and enjoy the spring.